Alright, this is going to be part 4 in a 4-part series on things I keep on the farm that I like to have on hand for certain species of animals. This is going to be my dog version. So, obviously, because dogs aren't livestock, at least to me, they're not, they're more pets, I'm more likely to take my dog to the vet than I am to take my goat to the vet. So, if something gets really serious, I'm probably just going to go to the vet with my dog. I'm not going to go screwing around trying to give it all sorts of meds and do all sorts of things to it. So, this is just kind of a general list of things that I like to have on hand for just like small emergencies that don't require a vet maybe, but if it gets ugly, scoop your dog up and run to the vet with it if it's, you know, it's going to be out of your hands. So the first thing I would have on hand would be a skin stapler. Okay, these work great for just bringing the wound back together and giving it a chance to heal. An Elizabethan collar, you know, the cone of shame, would be important to have on hand to keep the dog from chewing at the staples. Okay, so we had a Doberman that, I don't know what she did, she was running through the woods, and I think she hung up on some old barbed wire fence that we didn't know about, and she cut herself right on her shoulder here and took a big V flap of skin ripped up. And so we cleaned it and got it all cleaned up, and we stuck a few staples in there and put a cone of shame on her, and we got it all fixed up here at home. You know, it wasn't a big deal. She didn't yelp or care. We didn't even know. We just saw it later. Like, what is on her? What is that? We're trying to brush it off. And we're like, well, ooh, she cut herself. So, you know, that's something you can handle at home probably. Another thing would be you can have fluids on hand. Again, once my dog, if it gets to the point where I think I actually need to give it fluids, I'm going to go to the vet. I'm not going to screw around with it because I don't want to lose my dog. So, but you know, if it were an emergency, you know, the world had shut down, there were no vets, something, it'd be nice to have saline solution on hand for sub-Q fluids, or even Ringer's lactate if you can get it, for sub-Q or IV fluids. If you can get an IV, you know, in your on your dog, you can do jugular, you can do on the arm here. I'm not good enough for that. So jugular is always my choice because it's a much bigger vein going down there. The next thing I would have on hand would be 22 gauge and 20 gauge needles, as well as different sizes of syringes. I would prefer probably for dogs to have 3 cc, 6 cc, 12 cc, and 60 cc's. The 60 cc syringe is good for just fluids, to give 60 cc's of fluids at one time. And of course, depending on your dog, you know, if you have a little teeny tiny chihuahua, 60 cc's on one side of your dog's rib cage is probably going to be way too much. Now, my 95 pound borable, that you're not even hardly going to notice that, is going to flatten out pretty quickly and start to be absorbed. So, you know, that depends on the size of the dog as well. I like to have stitching needles and suture, as well as super glue, to go along with my skin stapler. Because sometimes just a little dab of super glue can keep those edges together and you can quit worrying about it. I've definitely put some sutures in dogs before I knew the handiness of having a stapler. And, you know, you can use that as well. I've even used a stitching needle and dental floss in a pinch years and years and years ago to reaffix this big M-shaped flap of skin that had been, I don't know, the dog ran into something, you know, I don't know. We live on an old farm that somebody farmed before us, and brambles grown over lots of stuff that we don't know what's in there. And so we find old barbed wire fences, we found old cars, some sheet metal. So I suspect that dog hit sheet metal and just rolled that skin up. And I took dental floss and a stitching needle and just put some stitches in there to hold it back down until it could heal itself back together. Super glue is great for just holding little tiny cuts like that long. Push them together, run some super glue in there, and it's probably going to heal up okay. I would like to have a scalpel or sharp scissors around just to cut off any nasty edges of some cuts and owies, so that it's not, because you're not going to get dead tissue to heal back together. Obviously, it's in the way. So you need to cut the dead tissue off until you're all to the nice, clean, healthy tissue, and then butt those edges together so that they can try to, you know, mix together, matrix over, and become, you know, just a scar. Another thing I like to have on hand is nail trimmers. Sometimes dogs will, you know, crack their nails or something, and keeping their nails trimmed short obviously is a good thing to do in the first place preventatively. But if you need to, like, you know, cut some of the edges off and kind of work around a nail that's got a crack in it or something, having, you know, the proper equipment makes that a lot easier. I would definitely have soap, iodine, peroxide, paper towels, Q-tips, cotton balls, gauze, things like that to, you know, with wound care, to clean things out, get dirt out of owies, hair out of owies, you know, that kind of thing. An important thing to also have on hand would be vet wrap, which is that kind of a squishy wrap that goes around. It sticks to itself, but it doesn't really stick to hair. That's a good thing to have for dogs, is just to cover up owies because they tend to lick and chew at them. That would be one thing I definitely have, and I have a whole box of it in my bedroom, under my bed, but somewhere in the, you know, somewhere on the farm in the house, you know, have vet wrap on hand to cover up owies, because dogs will not leave them alone. They pick at them. That's why we put Elizabethan, you know, cones of shame on them, and we wrap them up, put socks on them and wrap that on there, you know, just some way to keep your dog from messing with the owie, because they will actually make it harder for the owie to heal. Of course, restraint's important. Not all dogs like to be tinkered with, like to have people mess with them. But obviously, most dogs would not appreciate stitches being put in them. A lot of the more stoic breeds will sit there and tolerate it. But would be, you know, for restraint, you want to have for sure a collar and a leash. Muzzle would be a good idea. And if you don't have a muzzle on hand, another leash just wrapped around the muzzle and then brought around the back and kind of tied just to keep the muzzle shut so they can't open it and get a hold of you. That would be a good idea. Towel. You can put a dog in a towel to take it to the vet, or if it's a big dog, lay a blanket down, put the dog on the blanket, and have two people hold the two corners and get it transported to the car. That would be another good thing to have. As far as injectables go, for my dogs, again, not probably going to do a whole lot of injectables. I'm going to take my dog to the vet. But in a pinch, I would always want to have vitamin E or vitamin B on hand, vitamin E, and maybe antibiotics if I think that I can fix this at home because the vet clinic blew up. I don't know. I'm more likely to go to the vet and have the vet figure out what's going on than I am to treat my own dog. But again, vitamin B, if my dog's not eating well, seems kind of off, lethargic's not, I don't know, just doesn't seem right. Vitamin B is pretty safe. You can give lots of it. Same thing with vitamin E. You can give a lot of that pretty safely. The last thing I would have on hand would be probiotics. If my dog just seems kind of irpy or kind of has diarrhea, throwing up, you know, mildly, and just seems kind of blah, is not real interested in food, probiotics can fix a whole lot of things. And probiotics you can get over the counter, just like an acidophilus pill from, you know, the health food store for humans. It can be a probiotic from the vet. It can be yogurt, live culture yogurt. Make sure that it's live culture and that it's not pasteurized and just all dead flavored yogurt. You want it to be a live culture yogurt. It should say on the container, contains live cultures. You can use yogurt to do that as well. I tend to have a couple different brands that I use, and I'll use one and switch to one the next 12 hours and then go back to the other one. And that way I figure I'm kind of covering more bases. And you can do probiotics as long as you want. They're not going to hurt anything. And they can sometimes offer a whole lot of relief for a dog with just a tummy upset. So if you can think of anything else that you'd like to see in your doggy cupboard at home that you think is important that I've missed here, please add it to the comments below so that people can learn from your experience in addition to mine. All right, I hope you guys enjoyed this series of taking care of things at home, and I'll talk to you next time. Bye.